This Memorial Day weekend, the death toll from coronavirus in this country, well, it passes 98,000. We're closing in on the 100,000 mark. There are more than 1.6 million reported cases across the country as states reopen and Americans crowd into pools, beaches, onto boardwalks. That is, the President of the United States marks the holiday with solemn moments at Arlington and at Fort McHenry in Baltimore. That is a solemn president, the teleprompter president, the one who shows up from time to time. But the real President Trump, the unfiltered president, as always comes out on Twitter, as this president is spending Memorial Day weekend lobbing threats, conspiracy theories, and insults, with more and more Americans dying every single day from the coronavirus. The president makes fun of Joe Biden, of him being a real man, being a responsible adult, makes fun of him for wearing a mask, retweeting this from a Fox News host. A mask that is really one of the only ways that Americans can protect themselves now. A mask just like ones millions of Americans have been wearing for weeks. Millions of you. A mask that the president is afraid to be seen in and still refuses to wear in public. And then there is the president's extremely irresponsible, bullying, and potentially deadly threat today in the middle of this deadly pandemic to move the Republican National Convention from Charlotte, unless North Carolina's Democratic governor can guarantee they'll be allowed to have a packed house. A packed house, get this, in a state that has already seen more than 24,000 cases of coronavirus. A Republican source telling CNN the president is trying to make Governor Roy Cooper the bad guy so that if changes have to be made, he takes the fall. But this president on Memorial Day weekend, as the death toll from the coronavirus gets closer to 100,000, this president really taking the low road, getting into the mud with his insults and accusations against anyone that he views as a potential enemy. There's his attack on a Democratic congresswoman, congressman, I should say, and veteran Conor Lamb. The president calling him, quote, an American fraud, just days ahead of Pennsylvania's primary, and falsely claiming that the congressman voted for Nancy Pelosi for House Speaker. He did not. But facts don't matter to this president, as long as a lie takes down someone on the other side. There's a president's doubling down on his baseless accusations that MSNBC's Joe Scarborough, with whom he has a running feud, had something to do with the death of an aide in 2001 who hit her head and died in what police ruled an accident. Does he care at all that there is a grieving family out there? Apparently not, if he can wield a young woman's death as a political weapon. There's a president retweeting a supporter who called Joe Biden a racist, insulted Hillary Clinton, slammed Stacey Abrams, a potential running mate of Joe Biden's, for her appearance, and threw in another slam calling Biden a racist. The president of the United States tweeting and retweeting garbage on a weekend that is supposed to be about honoring American heroes who made the ultimate sacrifice. And with the coronavirus still ravaging this country, the president criticizing someone about their weight. Perhaps he doesn't own a mirror or a scale. And for this president, of all people, to attack Biden on race, you would think that the words would stick in his throat if he had any shame at all. Now, the fact is, when Joe Biden said this to Charlemagne the God on The Breakfast Club, it didn't land well.
But I tell you, if you have a problem figuring out whether you're for me or Trump, then you ain't black.
Joe Biden knows it was a joke that was inappropriate in that moment and that his familiarity with black culture would be over-scrutinized. So he apologized for that and that the same day in a call with the National Black Chamber of Commerce. The former vice president saying, quote, I shouldn't have been such a wise guy and insisting that he doesn't take black voters for granted. So Trump calling Biden a racist is rich because there is an enormous difference between an ill-timed joke made by a man who served alongside the first black president and a man who launched his political career trying to tear down the first black president and promoting the racist birther lie that that black president was not born in this country.
And if he wasn't born in this country, which is a real possibility, I'm not saying it happened, I'm saying it's a real possibility, then he has pulled one of the great cons in the history of politics.
A racist lie that he reportedly still believes behind closed doors. And let's not forget, this is the president who said this about deadly white supremacist violence in Charlottesville.
You also had people that were very fine people on both sides. You had people in that group, excuse me, I saw the same pictures as you did.
This is a man who danced around the question of whether he would disavow David Duke, the former leader of the Ku Klux Klan.
Well, just so you understand, I don't know anything about David Duke, okay? I don't know anything about what you're even talking about with white supremacy or white supremacists. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know, did he endorse me or what's going on? Because, you know, I know nothing about David Duke. I know nothing about white supremacists. And so you're asking me a question that I'm supposed to be talking about people that I know nothing about.
He called black athletes who dare to protest police brutality and racial injustice sons of bitches.
Wouldn't you love to see one of these NFL owners, when somebody disrespects our flag, to say, get that son of a bitch off the field right now, out, he's fired. He's fired!
He called African nations sending immigrants to this country, quote, shithole countries. And on and on and on. But Joe Biden, supposedly the racist, it's shameless. And then there's the president's self-serving attempts to convince Americans that we can all go back to our pre-pandemic normal. And for this president, nothing says normal like a few rounds of golf. I've got to be honest. I really don't care if the president golfs. Nobody cares, well, except this president, tweeting today that he hasn't golfed in almost 3 months and attacking the former president, Barack Obama, for golfing. Well, here's the issue with that. He sure cared a lot about his predecessor's golfing. He talked about it over and over and over. Let's roll the tape.
Obama, it was reported today, played 250 rounds of golf.
Everything's executive order because he doesn't have enough time because he's playing so much golf.
Obama ought to get off the golf course and get down there.
I'm going to be working for you. I'm not going to have time to go play golf.
He played more golf last year than Tiger Woods.
This guy plays more golf than people on the PGA Tour.
I love golf. I think it's one of the greats, but I don't have time.
But if I were in the White House, I don't think I'd ever see Turnberry again. I don't think I'd ever see Doral again.
But I'm not going to be playing much golf. Believe me, if I win this, I'm not going to be playing much golf.
That's the issue here, hypocrisy and projecting. Project much? The fact is, just yesterday, President Trump made his 266th visit to one of his golf courses since taking office less than 3.5 years ago. At this point in his presidency, it's important to point out that Barack Obama had played 98 rounds of golf. That is according to a count by CBS News. And you know what they say? There is a tweet for everything, because Donald Trump tweeting in 2014, quote, President Obama has a major meeting on the NYC Ebola outbreak with people flying in from all over the country, but decided to play golf. The death toll from Ebola in this country, 2 people. The death toll from coronavirus right now, closer and closer to 100,000. Those are the facts. CNN's White House correspondent is Caitlin Collins, and I want to bring her in now. Caitlin, good evening to you. Thank you so much for joining us. There's a very serious question tonight about where the country is heading with the rates of infection. And tonight and tomorrow morning, people will see this headline about half of the states investigating cases of dangerous syndrome in children. But none of that has been top of mind for the president this weekend, has it?
No, it hasn't. And the president is active on Twitter every weekend. His aides know it. They prepare for it. But this weekend really did stand out when you saw what the president was focusing on, what he was choosing to amplify, and what he was not drawing as much attention to, including the death toll getting close to 100,000, unfortunately, here in the United States. And instead, the president was repeating these conspiracy theories about an anchor and murder that are baseless and have been debunked. He's amplifying a message from one of his supporters, disparaging several top politicians, a supporter, we should note, who has a history of racist and sexist remarks. And that's what the president was focusing on instead. And then yesterday, you know, you were talking about how he spent 2 days playing golf this weekend. He was criticizing the media for covering the fact that he went and played golf 2 days in a row this weekend during the pandemic, something that, as you rightly noted, he criticized his predecessor for doing.